Sam, how should the president prepare for any meeting he might have with Putin later this week?
Well, Anna, I just have to respond to the comments that President Trump made earlier. Why wouldn't President Trump confront Vladimir Putin over election interference? The only logical explanation is he doesn't want it to stop because he views it as helpful to his 2020 election campaign. When kicking off any potential encounter with Vladimir Putin, President Trump should lead with intelligence related to what we know about Russia's ongoing attack on our country. A failure to do so is really acquiescing to making the American people victims again. President Trump should also know that Putin is probably looking forward to a meeting with President Trump because past encounters have really helped advance Russia's attacks against the United States. We just look back to the Helsinki summit when President Trump made major counterintelligence missteps, like failing to bring a note taker into the meeting and undermining the U.S. intelligence community. Putin is probably expecting more of the same. Now, Anna, even if President Trump does raise election interference, that doesn't mean the two leaders can't find common ground. Russia worked with the United States on the first Iranian nuclear deal, and because the Iranian threat is resurgent at this time, President Trump and Putin could try to discuss that as well.
This island of 23 million people is a vibrant democracy that sits just across the sea from the world's largest one-party state. I'm Matt Rivers in Taiwan, officially known as the Republic of China.
And I'm Stephen Jiang in Beijing, the capital of what's officially known as the People's Republic of China. This name has existed since 1949, when the communists won a brutal civil war and forced the previous government to flee to Taiwan.
Both sides set up their own governments, each claiming to be the only legitimate ruler of the entire Chinese territory, and decades of hostility ensued. There was no travel, trade, or communications between both sides, and the threat of military action was a constant presence. But tensions began to ease in the 1990s when Beijing and Taipei authorities began a series of meetings and correspondence that deliberately put aside the issue of sovereignty in favor of resolving practical matters.
These dialogues paved the way for economic and cultural cooperation. Businesses from Taiwan have invested billions of dollars here on the mainland, the world's most populous country and second largest economy. And millions of mainland tourists have flocked to Taiwan after direct flights resumed. But still, China insists Taiwan is a breakaway province that must be reunited with the mainland by force if necessary.
Since Taiwan became a democracy in the late 1990s, cross-strait relations have fluctuated depending on which of the two main political parties is in power on the island. Bilateral ties warm up when the Kuomintang, the party that favors closer ties with China, rules Taiwan, and relations deteriorate when Taiwan's leader is from the Democratic Progressive Party, which traditionally supports Taiwan independence.
Tensions have been climbing since 2016, when the pro-independence party's nominee Tsai Ing-wen was elected president. Chinese President Xi Jinping has hardened his rhetoric and policies towards Taiwan.
With analysts seeing increased Chinese military drills near Taiwan, many people here are wary of the growing strength and ambitions of their massive neighbor just across the sea, fearful that their unique way of life, cultivated over the last seven decades, may be under rising threat.